Wow, so that's what it sounds like when you put a stereo widener on every track.
Today I'm going to look at United Plugins Expanse 3D plugin versus some free VST plugin options. But first, please like, subscribe, and hit that bell to know when my next video is coming out. Keep watching to the end of the video to hear my conclusion and what it sounds like when you use a stereo widener on every track in a mix at the same time. So Expanse 3D bills itself as a psychoacoustic processor using some complex internal techniques, ranging from phase offsetting to delay networks, to create space in certain frequencies. This sounds somewhat similar to how hardware exciters work, such as BBE Sonic Maximizer or Aphex Oral Exciter. So I'm going to bring in a really old mix from the early 2000s and see if we can liven it up. Let's listen. Let's activate Expanse 3D at its default setting. Okay, so that's a pretty big difference. I'm hearing widening across the spectrum, almost like a very short reverb has been added to the mix. The low end sounds fuller now too. Mono compatibility is crucial with any widening plugin, because they, by definition, change phase, and you can wind up with something that sounds amazing in stereo, but garbled in mono. Let's check the mono compatibility here. So I've switched to mono, now I'm going to hit bypass on Expanse. That sounds pretty much the same in mono. I think I'm hearing a slight change in the highs. And a little bit of gain difference. But I'm not hearing the telltale slapback effect that you hear with some stereo wideners. So far, so good. Let's take a look at the interface and see how it works. So the first thing is the width knob. According to the manual, the width setting is 100% mono compatible and reduces the amount of stereo effect on the sub bass the higher you go. This is great. As I mentioned before, you don't want phase effects on your sub bass. This could cause your subs to cancel out, and you don't want that on a dance floor. Let's raise the width. Indeed, as I raise this up, I hear the most effect on the synths, mid-range, and hi-hats. Now, at the higher settings, I'm hearing a little slapback on the transient instruments. Let's switch to mono again. So actually, the width setting holds up pretty well in mono. Even at high settings, I'm not hearing the slapback on transients. Not bad. I mean, I wouldn't go this high with it, but at the halfway setting, flipping to mono, this is very useful. Good job. So you have some processing options here too underneath width. Inverted, which can be used to put tracks into separate spaces so they're not sharing the same frequency offsets. And alternate, which appears to be another type of algorithm to try. Let's take a listen. Actually sounds a little bit wider. Let's try this in mono. Again, despite this sounding really processed when it's on, It holds up really well in mono. So this tells me that they're doing a lot of mid-side processing here. Now, of course, you don't want to go too crazy on the side or stereo processing, and it's very tempting to do that. If you do that, you are introducing phase elements into the mix, which could have unpredictable consequences. If you are listening to a stereo setup and it's not quite right, things could start canceling out. So less is more with these kind of plugins. Next is depth. Let's check it out. Interesting. On its own, it doesn't seem to be doing much to the stereo image. It actually sounds almost like an upward compressor, where it's bringing up some of the background elements, kind of thickening the sound. Let's add the other band back in and see what happens. Okay, there's our stereo information. Let's put that at 50%. That's interesting. It's tempting to look at each of these as different bands, but they're definitely not that, because the depth needs the width to work. So as the documentation says, this is definitely working more in the mid and upper mid range. Let's check mono compatibility. Yeah, this is interesting because the mono compatibility doesn't seem broken at all, but I still hear there's a bit of equalization difference, a bit of character difference. I hear more mid-range with the depth cranked, even in mono. Now we have the section with perhaps the least familiar name. I did not know this, but apparently we perceive low frequencies as coming from below and high frequencies from above. So height attempts to exploit this phenomenon by processing the lowest and highest frequencies with saturation, dynamics, and an anti-aliasing algorithm. Let's check this out. This sounds the most like a traditional exciter that I've heard so far. You have those smooth lows and smooth silky highs. Interesting. So on its own, we can really hear the low end deepens and the high end becomes a little stronger, brighter, but not harsh at all. I'm impressed with how smooth this sounds. Let's bring up the other controls and hear how they interact. Again, the depth doesn't really seem to be that audible until the width is up. I have to say, it's quite fun just turning the knobs and finding what works. I like that playful aspect of this. The plugin this reminds me of the most is the venerable UpStereo by QuikQuak, which also uses saturation and can add low and high end EQ. Let's take a listen. You can see a lot of phase shifting happening here. To me, it's a rather aggressive plugin, which is generally not suited for full program material. Here you can see that it causes a lot of phase shifting through the material and has a pretty distorted sound. But you can have a lot of fun with this on instruments, and the bass and air EQ are very helpful for getting a scooped Baxendall radio sound. Ozone Elements is sometimes given away for free at places like Plugin Boutique. If you have this, it comes with the stereo imager, and it's a good one. I found it quite subtle, which is a good thing, and it's fully mono compatible. Next up is Polyverse Infected Mushroom Wider. This one is very popular on the groups and forums, and the cool, easy-to-use interface says why. Now, I find this one to be pretty aggressive, so let's check it out. I'm hearing a slight slapback on the kick. Let's check in mono. Yeah, definitely a little bit of that echo can be heard, so it's not quite as transparent as the other plugins we listened to. So for me, Expanse 3D comes out on top. True confession, I used Expanse 3D on all the backing tracks in my last video, which you can see up above, because they were all old MP3s and I wanted to quickly spruce them up. I think we're going to start seeing Expanse 3D pop up in many mastering engineers' chains soon, mark my words. So this is a strong recommend for me. It's on special for $34 as of this video. So I'd sweep that up if you're looking for more control over your stereo widening arsenal. Okay, just for fun, let's try putting Expanse 3D on every track of a mix. I painstakingly inserted and auto-gained Expanse 3D on all 53 channels of this mix, including the effects sends. Why not? Let's see what happens. Wow, so that's what it sounds like when you put a stereo widener on every track. Well, I really don't like what that's doing to the kick drum. It's bringing out the mids and there's a slapback delay. I'm gonna turn this down a bit. That's better. Let's try it with an instance on the main bus as well. Whee! Oh my. That's not good. Too much delay and phase shifting. I'm gonna invert the width. Oh, that sounds way better. Of course, you should never do this. And you can hear where Expanse sounds good in the mid-range material, gives it some more space, but it needs careful tuning for low-end and percussive material. All right, that was a mess. Thanks for watching. You should check out my other videos on VST plugins right now if you enjoy plugin reviews and tutorials. Click the links here. Please like and subscribe and help the channel grow. What stereo tunes do you like? Let me know in the comments below. See you next week, Pale Blue Daughters.